We want to talk some more about volume and how we can find volume. We know one way to find it, looking at cross sections and asking about what's happening with the area of the cross sections. But you might say, is there another way? And for that, we turn to the humble onion. Now, people often say calculus is a lot like onions in that there are many layers, and also there might be some tiers involved. But in our case, let's start by just actually looking literally at an onion. So here's an onion that we've cut in half. And you might say, what if I wanted to find the volume of this onion? Well, if we look at it, it actually can come apart in a fairly natural way. You see, there's all these sort of layers, layers upon layers upon layers. And so we can say, aha, somehow we can get inspired and say, maybe what we should do is think about, is there a way to find volume by doing something similar? In other words, by taking our shape and breaking it up into these different layers and trying to understand what's happening there. So that's our goal for today, is to say, hey, maybe we don't have to look at only cross sections. Maybe there's something else to be said for looking at a different way to break up our shape. So today's goal is we're going to talk about something called volume by using the shell method. Well, all right, let's begin. So our basic setup is still the same. What we're going to do is we're going to take a region, and in this case, let's say here's our region right here, and we're going to spin it. Now, of course, when we spin, we can spin around anything, and when I say anything, around any line. In this case, it looks like we're spinning this way. And as we spin, we're going to form a shape. And our goal is, what can we say about the volume of that shape? Now, the question becomes, how do we understand how we break things up? Now, previously, we said, hey, we're going to break things up, and when we spin it, the shape that we're going to form looks maybe like a disc or a washer. But now, we say, okay, let's say we take a little tiny piece. So here's our little tiny piece, and we spin it. And when we spin it, the question becomes, what's our shape? What are we seeing that's emerging? Well, we see it's not going to be a disc or a washer. It's a different shape altogether. So these are called shells. So I guess you could say we're doing a little bit of a shell game today. But really, what you should think of it is think of them like little cylinders. So we have these stacked cylinders, one inside the other. And we can say, look, if we can understand what's happening with the cylinder, then if we put them all together, then that's we can understand what's happening with the volume. Because what we've done is we say, I can break it up into these little parts. So that now raises the question, well, what can we say about the volume of one of these little shells, one of these sort of thick cylinders? Okay, so let's take a look. So here we go. We're going to start with our shell. So there's our shell. And now we pull out some industrial strength scissors. And we're going to cut all along one side. So now, lo and behold, we've cut our little shell. And we come out and we lay it flat. So this shell becomes a box. Now, you will say, but it's hard to lay it flat. It is true, but when it's fairly thin, then it lays flat fairly easily, and the distortion tends to be very minimal. So now we are after the question, well, what can we say? How do things translate? Well, a couple of things aren't so hard to see. So for instance, the thickness of the shell becomes the height of this little three-dimensional box. Okay, well, that's good. So in other words, sort of the thickness in one setting of the shell becomes the thickness of the box. Well, what else can we say? Well, we can talk about the height here. Now, if I look at the height, that translates into the other side. So we'll say the height of our shell translates into the height the box. So now we've translated the thickness of our shell becomes the thickness of our box. The height of the shell becomes the height of our box. One thing left. What's that one thing? Well, we need to understand, where does this other dimension come from? So let's say we call this our width. Well, if we think about our setting here, this part right here is the result of going one time all the way around. So in other words, it's the circumference of our shell. So our circumference up here in our shell becomes our width down here. All right, so now let's think about our volume. We can say our volume of our shell is approximately our volume of our box. And again, you might say approximately, right? Yes, and the approximation gets better and better. See, that's the whole idea of calculus, is that as we get smaller and smaller, in other words, our shapes get closer and closer to the right shapes, our approximation gets good, our error goes away. All right, so now we think about our volume. Well, some things are easy to see. Our thickness, okay, that was pretty straightforward. Good. Now, the thickness goes to the thickness. The height goes to the height. And now, the radius. Okay, there's this thing, 2 pi radius. What is that? Well, that is circumference. If you think about a circle, the circumference of a circle is 2 pi times the radius. So that's our width. So now, what is this r of x? What's this f of x? What's this delta x? So let's go back to our picture to talk about what's actually happening here. So in our basic setting, what we have is we have some region. We'll make it fairly simplistic. So here's our region. And let's say we're going from A to B. All right, there's our region. And we have our curve, y equals f of x. Now, where's the r of x? The r of x is the radius. So in the part up here, in terms of the shell, this is our radius. Where does it fit into our picture when we're spinning? Well, the answer is, we say, where are we spinning around? So we might say, well, we're spinning over here. Then the r of x will be the length from our slice, because we always think about our slice and what's happening to it, to where we spin around. So that's where the r of x comes from. So what's the formula? The formula says the volume comes from the integral from a to b, 2 pi r of x, f of x, dx. But I don't think that's the best way to remember it. Think of it in the following way. Integral says add up, adding up from a to b. 2 pi, the radius. Now, you think about what does that mean? Well, the radius is saying from where your slice is to where you're spinning. What's that distance? So that's the radius, from your slice to where you spin. The f of x, what is that? Well, the f of x, that's really like a height. How tall is your shell? And the d of x, that's really a thickness. So when I remember the formula, I really remember it as 2 pi radius height thickness. Now, one nice thing to help convince ourselves that we're kind of on the right track, in other words, this is a volume, is to think about, well, what should a volume consist of? A volume should really have three measurements involved because it's three-dimensional. So if we think about it, we say, okay, a radius, that's one measurement, a height, there's number two, and a thickness is number three. So that says, hey, this is a reasonable way to think about what a volume should be. So that's good, a sign that we're doing something right. Isn't it nice to know you're on the right track? All right, so we've now talked about finding a volume of revolution in two different ways. So the question becomes, well, what do we do with these two different versions? And so the answer is, well, you use whichever one is best. Now, what does that mean? In certain settings, you'll see that some applications are easier done if you use the washer method. In other applications, it's easier if you use the shell method. Sometimes you don't have a choice. And occasionally, this is where things get fun, you can use either. Now, why do I say things get fun when you can use either? Well, the question is, suppose you do a volume of revolution problem by the washer method, and you get some answer. And then you say, look, I'm going to do the same problem, but I'm going to use the shell method. So washer method, shell method. What's true about your two answers here? What must be true? The thing is, they have to be the same. Because it's the same thing that's being measured. So it doesn't matter how you compute what it is you're after, the answer should be the same because the volume is one number. It is what it is, as you might say. So what does that allow us to do? Well, sometimes it allows us to say, hey, I can transform one type of problem into another type of problem. Maybe I have a shell method, I transform it into a washer method, or vice versa. The consequence of doing that says, hey, maybe one integral is hard, but another integral is easy. So having that power and that flexibility to flip into different settings gives us a lot of extra advantage in some situations. Now, there's always a question. How do I know which one to use? And that's actually a really good question. So let's think about it. So let's say where we're at. And when I want to rotate around a line. So let's suppose I want to rotate around a line, something on the form x equals a constant. Well, what is that? Well, x equals a constant says I have something like here's a line, x equals k. So here's my line, x equals k. And I have a choice. I can integrate where I slice in a either vertical fashion or I slice in a horizontal fashion. So let's talk about what happens. So I'm going to try to be a little bit consistent here. So when I have this vertical slicing, what's going on? So a vertical slicing says, what is it that's being perturbed, that small change? And you can see the thing that has a small change is in the x direction. So that's a dx. So when we're looking at an integral with respect to x, we're really talking about looking at what happens to a vertical slice. So when I rotate around a line x equals k, I only need to figure out what's happening to one slice. And in other words, what's the shape? And I see, lo and behold, that when I spin around the line x equals k, the shape becomes a cylinder. So when I integrate with respect to x, vertical slicing, around x equals k, I get shells. So I'm using a shell method. So another way I can do this is I say, okay, if I want to use the shell method around x equals k, do vertical slices. And there's all sorts of ways. Now, what would happen if we didn't do it around x equals k? What if we did it around something else? Like, for instance, around y equals k. So suppose this up here, here is y equals k. And we spun. Well, what would happen then? In that case, we'd say, hey, think about the shape. And when we think about our shape, we see that the shape that's being formed is a washer method. So when we're doing a vertical slice, which means we're integrating with respect to x, around the line y equals k, we get washers. Now, you can imagine that something sort of flips when we go, instead of vertical slicing, we go to horizontal slicing. Now, let's think about that. So horizontal slice, what does that mean? Well, it means I'm doing small perturbations in y. So this is my dy. All right, so when I'm talking about an integral with respect to y, we're really talking about a horizontal slice. Good. Now, just think about our cases. If I spin around x equals k, so I take this slice and I spin it. Well, it's going to come to a slice over here. And what's the shape? The shape will determine the method. Well, the shape that's being formed is a washer. So when I'm integrating, doing horizontal slicing, which means integrating with respect to y around x equals k, it's a washer method. Similar, if I go around y equals k, well, what do we see? It's a little bit too big. It'll go off the page. But what we see is it's forming a shell. I don't recommend memorizing the table. Instead, think about how we got the table. We say, okay, let's think about the way I want to slice. Does it make more sense to slice vertically or horizontally? Oftentimes, the rule of thumb is look at the way the equations are given. Is it, for example, everything written as functions of x? Well, that makes a lot of sense then to look at vertical slicing. Are things given as functions of y? That makes sense to look at horizontal slicing. And then say, okay, vertical, horizontal slice, where do I spin? And what does one slice sweep out? And then we have our answer. So I suppose I should step back just 1 second and do a little bit of a callback here. I want to point out something that now is a little bit important that maybe wasn't important before. All right. And that is, be really careful with your radius term. Previously, whenever we had the radius involved, we would square it. And so we could kind of squeak by and say, well, we might get our sign wrong, but we square and all right, it all goes away. But there's no more square. So now we got to be extra careful. So whenever we talk about radius, remember, this is a measurement. And whenever we have a measurement, this should be something which is greater than or equal to zero. So what that says is make sure you're paying attention. In other words, for instance, here, if I'm spinning and this is my shape, well, what should I have? I should take the x value here, subtract the x value from where I spin, because it's high minus low. But of course, if I had spun over here on this side and this was where I was spinning, then I would take from where I'm spinning to where the x value is. Because of context, always go high value minus low value. That's what you want to do to find it. All right, well, that's the idea. And wow, onions, way ahead of their time, right? Well, there's a lot of things to be seen. If we pay attention to the world around us, nature has solved a lot of problems already. And maybe we can learn something from taking a closer look. And maybe, well, more than maybe, we can learn by doing a little bit of practice. So now's a great chance to go and do some practice.